Hi, how are you doing? I'm going to teach you how to make sense of Feynman diagrams, know what all the squiggly lines mean, and work out if they're representing a valid particle interaction or if they're defying the laws of physics. Ugh. A Feynman diagram is a picture of what happens when particles interact with each other. Particles go in one end, come out the other, and some stuff happens in the middle. And to make sense of Feynman diagrams, you need to know three things. What all the lines and arrows mean. What all the particles in the Standard Model are, as well as their special properties like charge and spin. What the overall rules are. These are called conservation rules. But you could call them in-out rules, as in you can't get out a different amount than what you put in. Here's a Feynman diagram. The lines represent different particles, which are travelling through space and time, which are represented by these axes. Note that with one dimension of space, we're losing some spatial information here, so these really are schematics of what a particle interaction looks like, rather than an accurate depiction of our four-dimensional reality. Here's an example, with a little animation to go with it. Two electrons move towards each other, exchange a photon, and then move away from each other again. And that's what this looks like as a Feynman diagram. In this video, I'm drawing time going upwards, but some people draw it going sideways, which is quite annoying. So the first thing you need to do when you look at a Feynman diagram is to check which way time is going. Hopefully they tell you, and if they don't, then they're bad people. Drawing time going upwards is the most common way, so that's what I'm doing here. Okay, that's the basics. Now let's get on to part one of the three things we need to know. What are the squiggly lines? These are the four kinds of lines, each corresponding to a different kind of particle. Now, I can only explain this if I show you all of the particles. So here they are. These are the fundamental particles of the universe that everything is made of, as far as we know so far. But why are they organized like this instead of organized like this? Ugh. It's because some particles share similar properties, so we can group them together, kind of like my cheese collection. The straight lines represent the fermions, which are these particles. These other particles are all called bosons. Now, the difference between fermions and bosons at a basic level is the fermions make up the stuff in the universe, and the bosons are how the stuff interacts with each other, and they're called force carriers. In fact, everything we experience is made up of just these three fermions, the up and down quarks, which make protons and neutrons. And when you add electrons to the protons and neutrons, you get all of the atoms that we're made of and everything's made of, you're made of. The bosons, the force carriers, are all the other lines. We use a squiggly line for the photon, which is the force carrier for the electromagnetic field and is the fundamental force mediating every single human experience. The spiral lines are for gluons, which carry the strong force that keeps the nucleus of atoms together and interacts only with these specific fermions, which are called the quarks. Now, onto the weak force. The mediators of the weak force are the W and Z bosons and are represented with a dashed line. All particles interact with the weak force, apart from the gluons. If all this is a bit much to take in, don't worry, I've made a companion poster which you can study in your own time. The link is below. So finally, the Higgs boson, which we also use a dashed line for, and those are all the lines.
What about gravity, the fourth fundamental force?
We don't use gravity here, this is particle physics. You're supposed to ask about the arrows.
But what about the arrows?
Thanks for asking. These only appear on the solid lines of the fermions, and they point forwards in time for matter particles and backwards in time for antimatter particles. Because weirdly, in particle physics, an antimatter particle is exactly the same as a matter particle. It's just travelling backwards in time. But where on my little picture are the antimatter particles? Well, nobody ever bothers to draw them on the Standard Model, so I've done it here. Here they all are. There are antimatter copies of all of these particles, which have the same mass as the matter versions, but opposite everything else. And while we're actually drawing actually all the particles, I may as well draw the different colour charges of the quarks and the eight kinds of gluons. These colours aren't real, by the way, just our labelling system for keeping track of the rules of the strong force. So this is actually all of the fundamental particles. Goodness, there's a lot of rules, aren't there? I'm sorry it's all so complicated, but that's just life, isn't it? So now we've covered part one and part two, what the squiggly lines mean and what all the particles are. This is enough to be able to read Feynman diagrams and make sense of what's going on. So let's apply this knowledge with some examples. Here's one we met earlier, showing two electrons interacting with a photon, and it's an example of an interaction via the electromagnetic force. Here are a couple more, but these are interactions involving the weak force, and here's a couple involving the strong force. You'll notice that these are all a similar shape, and I did that on purpose because I want to talk about the vertices. If you chop these in half, you get a vertex, which is basically a meeting point between three particles. And you can think of these vertices as the building blocks of a Feynman diagram. You can build most Feynman diagrams out of this basis set of vertices, which I'm not going to describe in detail now, but pause the video if you want to study them more. What is interesting about these is that they mean different things depending on how they are oriented in space and time. For example, this is an electron that has a change of momentum when it emits a photon. But if I rotate it, this electron becomes a positron. Remember, that rule about matter travelling backwards in time is just antimatter travelling forwards in time. And then this shows a positron and an electron coming together to annihilate into a photon. So different orientations can mean very different things. So with this basis set of vertices put in different orientations, you've got pretty much all you need to build any Feynman diagram. Let's look at some more complicated examples. Here are the electrons interacting again, but in the middle, the photon is spontaneously turning into an electron-positron pair before annihilating and turning into a photon again. See if you can work out what's going on here. This is a neutron, which is made of three quarks, up, down, and down. It decays into a proton via the weak force. A proton is made of up, down, up quarks. The W boson that's emitted then decays into an electron and an anti-electron neutrino. So this is how neutrons can turn into protons via the weak force and is known in nuclear physics as beta decay emission. This last one I'm going to leave to you to disentangle. See if you can work out what is going on here, and specifically, can you answer which force is mediating this interaction? Let me know in the comments below what you think. So now you know how to read Feynman diagrams, congratulations. But we don't yet know how to analyze them to see if they're valid or not. For that, we need to learn the underlying rules the particles follow, called the conservation rules of particle physics. But to avoid information overload, I'm going to cover that in my next video, so stay tuned for that.
I recently watched a great documentary on quantum physics on Magellan TV, who are sponsoring this part of the video. If you're outside of the UK, you might not know Jim Al-Khalili, as he's mostly on British TV, but he's a fantastic science communicator and a big inspiration to me when I started this channel. And his documentary is a brilliant summary on the origins of quantum physics. If you want to watch it, you can get it on a free trial of Magellan TV, a new streaming service founded by filmmakers, covering science, technology, health, physics, and many other fascinating subjects. It's got over 3,000 documentaries so far, and new shows are being added on a weekly basis, with a growing selection of shows available in 4K. So if you want to check it out, you can get a 1 month free trial to see what you think at this link, which you can click on in the description below. And this also helps me out because they know you've come from here. Thanks for watching, and I'll see you soon to delve deeper into this poster of the Standard Model, where we'll learn the third part of Feynman diagrams, where we understand the underlying rules that the fundamental particles follow. See you then.